Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, borrow and spend Republicans. Also, the V-Team takes a look at Spencer Collier's lawsuit. And 135 elites are called by the prosecution in the Hubbard case.
You know, has it ever occurred to you that instead of running around blaming me, you know, given the nature of all this new shit, you know, this could be a lot more complex. I mean, it might not be just such a simple, you know?
What in God's holy name are you blathering about?
Yeah, what the dude said. All this and much, much more coming up next on The V.
The Voice of Alabama Politics with your host, Bill Brett. Now, the number one political show in Alabama, The V.
Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team. Welcome all.
Good morning.
How you doing?
Thanks for having me.
Good, Jack. How are you doing?
It has been a crazy week in Alabama politics, and it just keeps coming. This week, a who's who of the politicos, business titans, and lobbyists have been called by the prosecution to testify in the Mike Hubbard trial. 135, Beth.
It's crazy. And, you know, 11 House members, 9 senators, that's a quarter of the Senate right there that's been called to testify. You've got Craig Pouncey, Billy Canary, Bob Riley, the Swiatek, Howell, and Ross people, David Bronner, Medicaid past, present, and future. I mean, everybody that's in Montgomery is on this list.
Susan, it just had to be devastating for Hubbard to get a copy of that list.
It had. I mean, you've got a former governor, a sitting governor is on this list. I mean, you've got... What it looks like to me from this also is it's kind of gathered by the indictment. And in other words, the names around any given indictment, there's a whole cluster of people that's working there. But this, I mean, from the broadness of it, this has got to be absolutely devastating for the defense.
Jack, if I had this many people testifying against me, I'd be going to Cuba.
Yeah, at least. Yeah, it's interesting because you know these people are being called because they were interviewed by the Attorney General's office during the early phases of this grand jury, and they said enough to warrant their coming back to testify on the trial, probably against Mike. And that does not bode well for him.
There's a lot of people on here, though, that are friends of the speaker. You know, Bob sure. Riley, to name a notable one, the people that are named the Republican House members are his cheerleading squad. So it's really interesting what they might bring to the table
and
for the prosecution.
Dale Marsh is also named among them.
So but the mm-hmm. most interesting to one to me is Greg Wren, who is no longer in the House of Representatives because he cut a deal
right.
to avoid jail time on one issue related to this case.
And rumor is that other people have cut deals too. We just don't know who. Of course, the funniest thing I heard is someone said, well, expect Bob Riley to be on a road trip in Alaska somewhere and will have a convenient accident. But we hear he's comfortable with what he's doing.
We hear he's comfortable with testifying, as is apparently Jimmy Rain. He's on here too. I'm sure that most of these people have already talked to the prosecution. If they haven't, they are currently talking to them. So if I were Mike Hubbard, I would be very, very worried.
You know, it's just one of these things. I heard early on we were talking about it, and we talked about who would be witnesses and who would turn on Mike. And it looks like even though his best friends are in here, they're still going to give testimony. And I can't understand how this many people testify against you or to your actions, and you don't get convicted, Jack.
At least a few of the counts.
Yeah.
It only takes one.
Mm-hmm. I mean, well, we know the solicitation of money from these lobbyists and corporate folks to help him bail out Craftmaster. That's a direct solicitation of money.
The judge, in fact, even made a special asked for a special exception with the judge on Wednesday, because a lot of these people have to be flown in from out of state,
and he doesn't want to have Bobby Abrams
and that
group.
Yeah, so they've got to have accommodations to make sure they're going to be here during the time they need to testify, not before or after.
Brett Buick, the head of Majority Strategies. Jack, that's one of the largest, if not the largest, mail peace house in the country.
Well, it is, and they supposedly Craftmaster cut their cost. Four Majority Strategies, and Mike on, you know, some alleged that on the back end.
And Barry Walker is on that list, too.
Mike got a kickback.
Yeah. I tell you, one of the things that I see, and I don't know how you skate around this, Bill Baxley, prominent attorney in Birmingham, is going to have to cross-examine some of the largest business owners, some of the most powerful men in that city. I mean, can you see him going after Rob Barton, you know, the head of Hoare Construction, and just nailing him? I mean, like he does with everybody else.
I mean, I would be interested to see a list of everyone who Bill Baxley represents in some capacity, just to know where. Because, you know, we know some of these people he represented when they testified in front of the grand jury.
Sure.
So how does it work where you've got, now you're cross-examining your own client in a different matter? I don't know. I mean, I can't say what that means, but I know that it looks fishy.
Well, this brings me to what happened this week. There was a hearing, a pretrial conference, a hearing on the Hubbard case. We all came prepared to hear arguments on the 404B. We came to hear arguments on the motions in limine, and we came to hear arguments on the admissibility of evidence. Susan, we went in there. The judge was ready. The prosecution was ready. What did Bill Baxley say?
Apparently, Bill Baxley was the only one in the room of about 30 or 40 of us that didn't know why we were there on Wednesday.
He said he didn't know why we were there.
He said, well, I thought we were just here to set the court date. So, Judge, I'm not prepared. I haven't prepared for this. And he repeated that several times. The problem I have is the judge let him go on that.
Yeah.
He just let, well, if the prosecution had shown up and done that, he would have sanctioned them somehow. But he just, it's okay.
Where's Lance Bell been for the last 2 years? Afghanistan? Because he's been on the case from day one.
Mm-hmm.
And if he's not ready, then that's not the court's fault. It's not the prosecution's fault.
Well, and anytime you've got a hearing set and you don't know what the judge is expecting you to argue, you call the court and you ask the clerk, what does the judge want us to talk about? What is going to be set in this hearing? You call and you find out. That's doing your job.
I really think that what he was trying to do here was underline the fact that he's pushing for it to be postponed until August. And so he's trying to underline the fact that they're not prepared
but
to go.
I thought
in May.
That was disingenuous. Mm-hmm. I thought the judge should have called him on that. I guarantee if Matt Hart had said something that stupid, the judge would have probably ruled against him on every motion. And we could not get to these motions because of Baxley. And now they're pushing for to move this case again.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll be 2 years, Jack. 2 years since he's been indicted. I mean, this is outrageous.
I think the judge has gone above and beyond the call of duty in granting all these delays. And we understand when Mark White left the case that Baxley did need time to get up to snuff on what was going on. But now it's pretty obvious. Even a third grader can figure out these guys are trying to, what is it y'all always say, deny, delay, and
deflect.
And deflect. I mean, it's clearly what they're doing.
This is, we got about 30 seconds, but this is a very important point. One of the things in motions in limine, that means to limit the testimony that can be given, the scope of it. One of the things that was brought up on Wednesday was this idea that the defense could use prosecutorial misconduct as a defense. Susan, the judge had already ruled on prosecutorial misconduct, but he seemed to open the window for them to do that.
He did. He seemed to be, you know, kind of discussing it out loud in his mind, even though he's already previously ruled on this in an order, I believe, that was set down last month, that this was not prosecutorial misconduct or selective vindictive. But he seemed to kind of open the well maybe door.
On Wednesday. Well, we're going to have to leave it right there with the well maybe door. I hope that one slams. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. We'll be right back with more news and analysis.
Tell her it's unfair. Can I get a quit? Everything you had, even talking in my
Now you chicks who agree that this ain't the way love's supposed to be. Let me hear, let me hear you say, yeah.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Susan, this past week, Spencer Collier, once the head of ALEA, filed a devastating lawsuit against Governor Bentley, his former senior advisor, Rebecca Caldwell Mason, his replacement, Stan Stabler, and a long list of others still to be named. It's a big suit. He's really going after him, and it read like a who's who, and he wants the answers to what
happened.
He does.
They sent the interrogatories out today. This week they were very revealing. Spencer Collier is not suing them, these people, in their office, by the way. He's suing them personally, which makes it different. And they've also opened the door for several other people to be named in this, which you could, anybody's guess as to who that's going to be. But in this could potentially cast a very wide net.
Well, it's her businesses, her husband's businesses. There's a lot of things in there, Beth, right?
Right. Well, and keep in mind, too, the reason why you would put Bentley in there in his individual capacity instead of his official capacity is if you sue in his official capacity as governor, if he is impeached or resigns or something happens, that suit then transfers to the new governor. So it would leave, then this is the way that he attaches it to Robert Bentley personally instead of to the office of governor or to the office of any of these other positions. So I think that's part of the strategy there, is they might be banking on Bentley not being the governor until this case carries out.
I mean, we know Spencer Collier for a long time. We know Governor Bentley for a long time. But these guys are at war, once friends. And this lawsuit, you know, from my look at it, I'm not a lawyer, I think he's got a case of wrongful termination and defamation.
I actually met Robert Bentley through Spencer Collier on, back in 2009. And they were famous friends. And I think there's no reason Spencer Collier would have turned on Robert Bentley for all the tea in China, except he was wronged. I mean, in looking at this objectively, you know, I just think, and people have told me that more than one person, the Rebecca Mason, when she had it out for you, Bentley was blind to it. He's like, you know, she was making all the decisions. Mm-hmm. She clearly didn't like Spencer for whatever reason.
And I think it's very, very telling that you know, she's in there. She's in there big time. But also, you look at how Bentley's handled this crisis. First, he comes out and he says, you know, he's punishing Spencer. That's in the public domain. Right. Then he comes out and says he's firing him because there's their wrongdoing over ALEA. Then they come back and go, well, maybe we didn't. And now they're coming out here and saying he was fired with cause. I mean, Beth, they can't make up their mind, can they?
Right. And, you know, because Spencer Collier is a public official, you're going to have to show actual malice, not just negligence on the part of the governor. And I think where he can get that is that the governor had this audit and didn't even bother to look at the evidence that showed that there was no wrongdoing. You know, he said that we're firing him over allegations of wrongdoing at ALEA. Well, he couldn't tell you what those allegations were. He completely disregarded the truth or any, you know, he acted recklessly. And it was shameful to me how he just completely went forward.
I think reckless is a very good adjective, because initially they said, well, he had a misappropriation of funds, and they couldn't prove it. The audit showed otherwise, so they had egg on their face and they had to come up with something else. It's ridiculous.
Right. It really is.
He's a good public servant, and he didn't deserve the treatment he got for attempting to tell the truth.
And this shows just how far out of the loop Bentley actually is, how out of touch he is with everything that's going on.
And this thing never had to happen. It went back to your partner and our former colleague.
My former partner.
Your former partner and our former colleague, Baron Coleman, who decided to give an affidavit in the Mike Hubbard trial saying that he believed he had evidence of prosecutorial misconduct. He first went to ALEA. Jack, we were all blindsided of this, but that is what has led to this train wreck, the firing of Spencer Collier, the scandal with Robert Bentley. I mean,
total domino effect. I mean, he filed an affidavit in court saying that he inferred or he concluded that information that he had discussed with Matt Hart was privileged information that Matt shouldn't have shared with him. But in court, it was decided otherwise. The judge didn't believe Barron.
Right. Yep.
And I was one that testified against him because I knew it to not be true.
Well, the judge clearly said he didn't buy it. He didn't buy it.
No, he didn't.
Now, one thing that people seem to be forgetting is that during that trial, the governor said, or that hearing, the judge said he wanted an investigation into Baron Coleman. People seem to have forgotten that that's what he said. But, Beth, this thing, it just took off over a matter of a few weeks, didn't it, and ended up with Bentley scandal.
It did, and the body count on this has risen so high so fast, and it all comes right back to Mike Hubbard at the end of the day because you've got, you know, none of this with Spencer Collier ever would have happened if he had been allowed to do his job and tell the truth. Everything in this comes back to somebody lying or being asked to lie, whether it's these ethics forms or whether it's, you know, Spencer Collier being terminated or whether it's the governor allegedly ordering them to lie about the grand jury. Everything comes down to, it's one of those times where the cover-up is bigger than what actually happened. And the body count, I'm just scared to see how high it gets by the time this is over.
Well, one of the things, you know, we know about Watergate is that the cover-up is usually worse than the crimes. We know that there are at least three investigations ongoing into the Bentley-Mason affair. One is federal, one is state, and one is with the Ethics Commission. Of course, I couldn't imagine the Ethics Commission coming back with a piece of shoe leather going, we found this. Does that count as evidence? I mean, these are good investigators, but they have to be signed off on by the whole commission, and that thing's just a joke. But, Susan, the Masons still have more problems with their ethics filings, right?
Right. And let me explain the ethics filings, where it usually makes you have a brain freeze, right, when you think about looking at people's ethics forms. These forms are designed so that any state employee, whether it be a teacher or whether it be the governor, has to disclose who they have business dealings with to see, so to let the general public decide if there's a conflict of interest there. John and Rebecca Mason's ethics forms are still in a disarray. In fact, John Mason went back and tried to, he did amend his forms for 2011, 12, and 13, and they're still not disclosing everything.
I mean, Jack, he left off businesses he owned, money he earned. I mean, is this just error, or is he trying to hide something?
There are plenty of people who are novices at this, and neither of the Masons ever had any political experience or knowledge of politics.
But, you know, every first
this.
Grade teacher well, in
know, it's
state
not an excuse. It's not an excuse. But, you know, it could be either. It could either be, you know, misfeasance or malfeasance.
Well, here's the problem I have with it. John Mason's 2014 form does not mention his company, JRM, at all. It appears that he's a consultant for Rebecca Mason, when at least I know one of his clients, the University of Alabama, paid him $12,150 in that year, and it never appeared anywhere on that form.
Must be nice to just forget about $12,000 he made
well,
in a year.
Well, like, when the university's giving you $300,000 over a period of years,
that's not worth mentioning.
$10,000.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I don't know. With the price of tickets for football games, they ought to have plenty of money.
All right, we're going to leave it right there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. We'll be right back.
In 1977, an 8-year-old boy picked up the game of golf from his father. The odds of that same boy then making it to the US and European pro golf tours? 1 in 7 million. The odds of the Big Easy winning the US Open twice? 1 in 1.2 billion. The odds of him having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 88. Ernie Els encourages you to learn the signs of autism.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. This past week, Senator Jim McClendon did something that's never been done, especially by a Republican. He got a lottery bill out of committee. It passed out of tourism 4-2, and the hope is that they can get a lottery bill in place so it can go before the people to vote on it. Beth, the people say they want to vote. Republicans are supposed to be the party of liberty, but they want to tell everybody what to do, how to run their lives.
Right, and I think that, you know, now the issue is coming down to which lottery bill are we going to vote on? Because I know there's been a couple different ones in the mix, and who, you know, whether it's we're just asking for a blank check or whether it's going to go to the general fund or to education or prisons or Medicaid, you know, that's where the fight's going to come in. I think that's what's going to ultimately doom this bill is when, as soon as you pin where the money's going, now you're going to have the lobbyists fighting over it. Because if it can't go here, somebody's going to want it to go over there.
The problem is, Jack, we've seen in every other state that's passed the lottery bill, when they have these, again, this is just a constitutional amendment that says we can come up with a way to run a lottery. So they don't want a lot of details in it because it gets beat around and it never passes.
Well, it does, but however, you know, that's why Siegelman's bill went down.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't tightly nailed down. And I'm afraid we don't know which brother-in-law is going to make a mint off this. I don't really care where the money goes, whether it goes to education or the general fund. I don't think that's the beef. I think the people care about who's getting rich off this deal.
Right.
Well, I think the bill basically is said they have a right to, right now it says, you know, we're going to amend the Constitution so we can have a lottery. I think they've got, they're getting put in there how the commission will work and how the funds would be divided between education and the general fund budget. But I tell you one thing, you know, we've got a big old hole in Medicaid, and the governor says he wants to fill it, and the people want to fill it. And if we don't fix it, we don't get those federal dollars, Susan. So this might be a way of fixing it.
Well, I guess it's coincidental that the Medicaid meetings are going on simultaneously with this lottery bill, which is probably a good thing. Remember, if we didn't fund Medicaid up to where it needed to be, we lose out on the RCO money, which is another $700+ million that we can bring in from the federal government. So these are all things that are going to have to be considered along with this lottery bill, because if we don't fund Medicaid, we don't get those dollars either.
Well, and keep in mind, though, too, that we only pay 30 cents on the dollar for Medicaid as it is right now. We're getting 70% of that money from the federal government, and we're sitting here saying we can't expand Medicaid because we don't want to take federal money. Breaking news, Alabama, we're already taking federal money for everything from Medicaid to roads to education. This is ridiculous. We have to expand Medicaid.
Leave it to a Democrat to want federal money. You know what I'm saying?
We're paying it, though. I agree with you.
Hey, listen, without federal dollars, we'd be the poorest third world country on the northern hemisphere. But, you know, hey, Jack, from a conservative standpoint, I never heard of Republicans that were opposed to lottery. I mean, Sheldon Adelson, one of the richest guys in the world, owns casinos.
Well,
it's this
moral thing that people back home don't want a lottery. Well, you know what? These are the only people over here at the State House who haven't read a statewide poll that shows that 70% of Alabamians would be in favor of some form of a lottery.
If you don't like it, don't play it.
You know,
I've got an ethical problem with gambling for money. I do. But listen, Americans ought to have the right to choose.
Need the right to vote on this. 80% of Republicans polled, voting Republicans, poll last year by McLaughlin, I think it was, said that they want the right to vote on it, whether it's a yes or a no. They want the right to vote on it, and I think they should be given that.
People really see this as benign, but, you know, we've said this before. There are people that say that only poor people play the lottery, and so if the Medicaid's being paid out of the lottery, then the poor people are paying for their own Medicaid. I mean, you know, hey, that's an argument.
And that's self-insurance?
Right, that's it. Well, as Jeff Foxworthy said, for redneck, a lottery is a retirement plan.
That or the jackpot at a casino. So,
talking about jackpots, Stars still failing Alabama.
Oh, my goodness.
We did a huge story on this, continuing story on the $47 million no-bid contract brought in by acting finance director Bill Newton. This $47 million package, Susan, it's got still got some problems, doesn't it?
It's still got some real problems out there, and one of the things that we discovered this last week was a presentation that was made to some of the agencies that are dealing with this, in which
just last week.
But now they've discovered that, oh gee whiz, well, we might have to hire more people, more programmers, more people to do this. Now, in the presentations they did initially that this CGI did to the state, it said that it would save money because it would be run more effectively. Well, everybody knows that that's a code phrase for you'll be able to reduce staff over time. But meanwhile, we're increasing staff. We're not even 6 months into this project, and we're already having to hire more people to handle the problems that we've got.
They want full-time staff, Jack, in finance to run this program.
To administer a program that's supposed to pay for itself
overnight.
You know, it's ridiculous. Yeah. And to no-bid it is, you know, it, I hate to use Claire's word egregious, but, I mean, it is a big up yours to the taxpayers of Alabama.
Right.
It is. And the program itself, if it had been purchased like it was supposed to have been, we would have gotten the whole package, and it would have worked. Now, they said, well, it had to cost us $100 million. Like it's not going to cost $100 million.
It's eventually going to cost more than $100 million. By the time you get the, oh, I'm sorry, you wanted that module, that'll be extra. We're going to have to hire extra employees over here in finance to be able to handle this. You're going to get well past that $100 million.
And it appears to me that Robert Bentley was distracted by something during all this.
Yeah.
I have no idea what it might have been.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no reason they should have ever slipped through.
Are there still tons of vendors that haven't been paid?
They claim that they've almost caught up.
Okay.
Almost caught up. So,
but it's still a bugger of a system. I mean, there are still people are having problems with it. They're having to continuously train people that were supposed to be trained before they ever launched.
So it's just one of those things that you look at, and people are disgusted in government. The real crime here, though, is that the governor, finance, and even some legislators say, oh, no, it's fixed. There's no problem. Nothing to see here. Move along.
Well, this is the same governor who told us we didn't have a budget deficit going into the election. He told us there was no budget crisis. We were fine. So what do we believe when he tells us?
Well, not much.
Same governor who said we didn't have a physical affair. So
right.
You know.
Well, you know, I don't know what you call it. But this is the same bunch that in 2012 borrowed $437 million from the Gas and Oil Trust Fund and said they'd pay it back. They swore they'd pay it back. We only got about 30 seconds. They just passed a bill saying, we ain't going to pay it back.
Should have smelled this last year when they skipped the payment on it and knocked the last payment to 2027. You had to see this one coming. We knew good and well that they were not going to pay this money back. The general fund doesn't have it to pay back in the beginning.
What I want for homework this week for our viewers is everybody to go home and call their credit card company and say, you know what, I changed my mind. I don't want to pay that bill now or ever and see what happens. That's exactly what we're doing.
And can you extend my credit line
while we're at it? Yeah, I need some more credit.
But, Jack, I mean, we really need some leadership here, don't we, that says what they mean and means what they say?
Well, you got two people in peril, the speaker and the governor, And I guess Del Marsh is running the state right now.
That's terrifying.
I don't have a problem with what's going on, except for things like stars. But it can only get better, as Howard Jones sang.
Yeah, well, it's only going to get worse before it gets better.
I knew. If this week was an example,
that's the part
of that
I didn't want to tell you.
Yeah, exactly. Well, that's our show for this week. You've been watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. You watch us because we watch them.